in hiring decisions.
Yeah, well, that's very good to hear. And then, you know, also of the people in those communities that actually want to start the business, getting the funding, you know, I'm wondering if there were any state programs to help them achieve the funding that they need to start these businesses.
Yeah, I guess depending on your perspective, sadly or otherwise, that was one of the proposals that was floated earlier this year at the legislative level. Should there be like a loan bank that would be used to give subsidized or otherwise competitive rates to the start of businesses involving these disproportionate impact folk? And that measure did not succeed. So it was a very forward-looking piece of legislation that would accomplish exactly what you're looking for. So that direct benefit, sadly, did not make it. But yeah, I think that's what's happening is the market to some extent will help take care of it. I do think that there are at least some investments involving people from these communities. You know, they'll take on some co-investors who can help them jumpstart their ability to get into the business. And I think that's actually happening. I think a lot of, if we look at the individual license applicants, I think there are definitely some diversity in the pool of applicants, although, frankly, it's still not great. I mean, I think the statistics that the Cannabis Control Commission put out as of, say, mid-June was, I think, 13% of the folks involved in the industry are some type of disadvantaged, whether it's women or minority or veterans or disabled or LGBT, which is another disadvantaged category as the state looks at it. But that still leaves 80%+ to folks who don't meet those categories, or at least not reporting that they meet those categories. So I think that's something that the Cannabis Control Commission and probably the industry as a whole is looking to do better on.
Well, I think that all aspects of business could do better on that. It's not even just the cannabis industry, but it's a problem across the board. But something else you mentioned too, which I'd love to delve into a bit, a lot of the state programs are very restrictive in terms of, you know, where people can consume. And when you're talking about the cannabis consumption cafes, if you will, how will they handle transportation to and from these cafes? Because obviously people are going to be driving to these cafes. How are they going to police the intoxication, the driving intoxication factor? And I mean, and if they're going to be putting some rules in place regarding that, cannabis actually stays in your system for 3 days. So a blood test wouldn't tell whether you're intoxicated or not. Have they addressed that at the commission?
Yeah, I think the answer is yes. I know that one of the big issues for them is they're worried about how many servings to be allowed at these cafes. I think the thought is that they want to limit it to a single serving, so at least you won't have the over-serving issue for most people as you leave. Again, that's something we'll have to see how the specific rules come out, and are they going to give more leeway on that in certain circumstances. But I think that's certainly one piece is the single serving idea on it. And the other one would just be they need to really encourage people to take cabs and Ubers and not drive back and forth. Otherwise, they're going to end up having the types of issues that'll cause, put disfavor on the entire effort. So I think that's why they want to pilot it. They want to make sure that they can keep a close eye on the effort and make sure that the people involved are responsible, that the people who are consuming are responsible. I think that's, we'll have to see what other specific measures they have in place. But right now, I know that that's a big focus, is watching out for how much you can consume on site.
I've always thought it would be interesting for companies that are starting these cafes, cannabis cafes, it would be very interesting for them to offer incentives for people to take public transportation or Uber. Like, for instance, you know, show a receipt at the door, or show your phone that you took an Uber to your cafe and you get a discount when you enter. Something like that, that would encourage the public to avoid driving, because, you know, the biggest nightmare for the cannabis industry would be one fatal car crash because someone was out consuming cannabis in a public setting. And, you know, suddenly it'll just dampen this enthusiasm for passing adult use laws in other states. So that'll be a very interesting challenge, I'm sure.
I kind of agree with you on that one, Snowden. That's exactly right. I think that's one of the reasons the state is taking its time, that it was part of the initial rules and they held back. And now they look like they're going to move forward, but only on a pilot basis for exactly that reason. They want to make sure that they don't want to have bad incidents that put the whole cannabis legalization effort in disfavor. I think they're being very careful. Some may say they're being even overly cautious, but I think ultimately they're putting the same weight on the scale as you are, that they'd rather take their time, get it right, make sure that see how it works in practice, and then if they need to get more expansive, and I bet that they will. I think a lot of the restrictive measures that are in place, once everyone lives with this for a year or two, they're likely to start looking to see where they can be a little more flexible and give a little more credit to people. But right now they're trying to fight the fear of the unknown, and they're trying to make sure that everything is as defensible as it can be so they don't get undue criticism by the opponents of cannabis.
And there are plenty of opponents to cannabis. We're having issues with our state here. And, you know, ever since the medical law passed back in 2012, I believe, there have been groups that have been trying desperately to undermine it, including arresting and incarcerating patients because, you know, they're carrying something they purchased at a dispensary that didn't actually comport with the criminal definition of cannabis under the criminal code. And we just had a big win recently in the Arizona Supreme Court. I don't know if you saw that episode or not, but it was a pretty significant win for the industry because for a period of about 6 months, an appellate court rule actually made it illegal for patients to carry tinctures. It had to be dried flower that you smoke only. So imagine giving that to a 5-year-old who has epilepsy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The laws have just been so ridiculous, but it's because there's such an enormous lobby here against cannabis. And part of it is the pharmaceutical lobby that is incentivizing elected officials to go against the program. So it's been an issue. But Massachusetts really had an advantage of being sort of a late adopter compared to Washington and Colorado, because a lot of the lessons that have been learned in those states that were among the first to legalize adult use cannabis, they were able to iron out a lot of the kinks. And so it seems from what I've read about, you know, all of the experiences of the people who are passing adult use laws now, they've actually been able to write in some of the laws that had to be readdressed later on after the ballot measures were passed. So, I mean, do you think that's the case in Massachusetts?
Absolutely. I mean, we were watching in participating in the initial rulemaking process that the commission undertook. And one of the big things that they would do is they would delegate out sections. They would make sure that whoever's drafting a section would look at all of the rules that were in place in the different jurisdictions, and they'd have spirited debate over which policies to adopt and which ones to change. And they really saw it as their mission to make sure that they got the best out of the different schemes that were in place, learn the lessons of experience, be able to try to avoid problems that came out. I mean, one of them, for example, is the issue of overproduction. They're very concerned about overproduction. And so that's part of the Massachusetts cultivation rules, is you only can do, you have a maximum acreage amount per company. Even if you have multiple sites, you can't go above a certain acreage of canopy in your cultivation. And on top of it, if you, they broke it into tiers. So like a 5,000 and below is a tier one, and 10,000 is tier two, and it goes up from there. But if you say do a tier three or a tier four business, which is, you know, 20,000, 30,000 square foot of canopy, if you wanted to get bigger and go up to tier four or tier five, you'd have to show that you fully occupy your existing allocation before they'll let you go up. They don't want people to speculatively go up a lot and then grow to that and end up not being able to sell the product legally, which would then leak into the black market or somehow get transported across state lines. So they are going to look very carefully about what you produce and make sure that you are able to have a use for the cannabis that you produce and not be in a situation where you're an overproducer who is going to have product that's going to be used for dangerous ends. That's one of them specifically that they took that have been experienced in other states before that.
And now, interestingly enough, I think that a lot of states are, and Canada as well, are experiencing shortages. Like there just aren't enough growers to meet the demand, which I find really interesting because there was that fear that oversaturation would either drive the prices down, that it would to the point where it would make it cost prohibitive to be in the industry. And that would just be the one consideration. And then on the other hand, you've got the overproduction. What do you do with the excess, like you said? So it's an interesting dichotomy there, isn't it?
It is. And the thing is that that's another piece that Massachusetts folk tried to deal with is the issue of what do you do with your existing medical patients who've been benefiting from medical cannabis in the state for close to 10 years at this point, and that they were one of the big vocal proponents at the adult use reg hearings to say, please don't, we don't want to get into a situation where the newly licensed adult providers who are medical providers will just take all their medical cannabis, dump it on the adult use side, and won't be able to access it very easily. It's something that the state required if they're joint use providers, medical and adult use, they have to leave a certain percentage of their product to medical uses only. And that's something that a lot of us have been very curious about how that's going to work in practice, because is it going to be something where they'll be leaving stuff for medical use that won't be getting used and there'll be shortages on the adult use side? You know, that's, again, we're still in the early days of this market and they may have to be revisiting some of these policies exactly your way. Is it going to be overproduction? Will it be underproduction? And will there be an adverse impact on medical patients, or will they be fine under the current regime? And I think that's really where the commission is watching and trying to see if it has to do any course correction along the way. But they're at least thinking about these issues. They've seen them in other states. A lot of the people who show up at these types of proceedings at the state level at the commission are aware of these issues because they've lived through the experiences in other states as well. So I think it's, again, Massachusetts as a relatively late adopter has at least some benefit that it's trying to apply in the way it's managing its scheme.
Well, I think that one state that they could look to for instruction on this would be California. When they passed their adult use law, it actually adversely affected the medical programs there and made it more expensive for patients to access what they needed. And there were new rules in place as well that increased the requirements for testing to the point where, you know, even people who tested their product in labs regularly were forced to test at every phase as opposed to testing the end products. And it really started driving up the prices. And the people who were impacted the most were the patients. And it started to make it unaffordable for the smaller businesses to really compete in the market because the costs were as high as if they were a large producer. So those are interesting challenges. And I think that just about every state has to grapple with what happens to the medical programs when you introduce the adult use programs, and will producers be incentivized to produce medicine as opposed to just producing recreational marijuana? So it's, yeah, that's a very interesting challenge you mentioned there. So I'm wondering, is there anything else that you think would be important for our listeners to know about what's happening in Massachusetts or what you're working on currently?
I think there's a couple different ones. One is I want to circle back to where we started. A lot of the talk was at the municipal level. It is something that a bunch of towns and cities have said no to cannabis, flat out. I think the number is well over 100 out of, say, 300-something towns have said nothing. They've completely prohibited it, and full stop, and that's the way it goes. And so a lot of the state, including some significant cities and towns have said no. And the other part is that even with respect to the